This video is about phototransistors. It corresponds to section 22.4 of Applied Analog Electronics. Now, a phototransistor is a type of bipolar transistor. So let's draw the symbol for a bipolar transistor. And I have drawn it here with just two connections, the collector and the emitter. The arrow is always on the emitter side, and the arrow points in the direction of conventional current flow. So when we're using this transistor, current will flow from the collector to the emitter. It also represents the base emitter diode. So this is an NPN transistor. The base, which I have not shown any wire for, because on phototransistors we don't connect the base with a wire. The base is p-doped here, and so we have a positive to negative diode between the base and the emitter. When that base emitter junction, when it's reverse biased, then the transistor is off, and no current flows between the collector and the emitter. When the base emitter junction is forward biased, and we get base to emitter current, then we will also get the transistor turning on, and we will get collector to emitter current. And the cool thing about bipolar transistors is that there is a large gain from the base to emitter current to the collector to emitter current, often around 100. So the transistor now is on, we will get a large current from the collector to the emitter. Let's take a look at the cross-section of an NPN transistor to see what's going on inside. All right, so here's a very rough schematic of the inside of a phototransistor. We have the N plus doped emitter at the top, the N plus doped collector at the bottom. These both have free electrons in them as charge carriers. In between, there's a very thin base layer, which is p-doped, so it has an excess of holes. The emitter is at our most negative voltage in the system, and our collector is at our most positive voltage in the system. So the base, however, is basically going to just get to a voltage that's, if there's any current flow from the base to the emitter, then the base is going to drop its voltage until it's no longer producing any current. So it's going to be basically the same voltage as the emitter, or pretty close to it. And that means there's no current flow. No current flow from the base to the emitter means no current flow from the collector to the emitter. That's not quite true, because there are thermal effects, which gives you a small current. That current is referred to as the dark current. And it's very temperature dependent, so it's something you sometimes have to worry about. Okay, when we have no light, the dark current is all we get, this tiny current. When we do get light, however, it can be absorbed by the silicon. When the photon is absorbed by the silicon, it basically knocks an electron free from the crystal lattice, and that electron becomes a mobile electron, and the place where it got knocked out of becomes a mobile hole, and these can drift. The junction that we're most interested in, the one that actually causes us to have a photocurrent, is the base to collector junction. Now, this junction is reverse biased. Remember that the base is close to the emitter in voltage, so it is negative with respect to the collector. A reverse biased semiconductor junction like that behaves like a photodiode. So when the photon knocks out a hole in an electron, they can separate, and we can get a current. Where does that current go? Well, What you're going to get is a current going from the base to the emitter. The hole is going to drift off into the emitter because that's the most negative point in the system. And the electron will drift off towards the collector. So we're going to get a photocurrent that's caused by the same effect that we have in photodiodes, but that photocurrent is going to become a base emitter current. That base emitter current then gets amplified by the transistor to make a much larger collector emitter current. So that's really the secret to phototransistors, is that they are a photodiode built in to an amplifying transistor, so that we get maybe 100 times as much gain, 100 times as much current per unit area as a photodiode would have. There are some trade-offs to that, but first let's take a look at an example. And what I'm going to do is show an example where I had used one of these little cuvettes, which has a 1 centimeter optical length inside, so you fill it with liquid and you can shine light through it and measure how much light gets through. That's a fairly standard way to try to identify what's in a liquid. Nowadays people often use much smaller things than these big cuvettes because, you know, this takes many milliliters to fill. People now use things like nanodrop spectrometers and stuff that only take a microliter. But the principle is the same, and it's a lot easier if you're doing hobbyist level stuff to try and deal with large absorbances that you get from a whole centimeter of liquid. Okay, so here's some measurements I made using cuvettes like that in a little setup where I was trying to keep any light out other than I had an LED and I had a phototransistor and I had space between them where I could stick a cuvette. And the curves I have here show how much current I got as a function of the collector emitter voltage at different light levels. So with no cuvette in place, so I had basically nothing to absorb light other than some air, I got a fairly large current. I don't remember the exact numbers, but you can see it's the purple line right at the top. If I stuck the cuvette in, the cuvette was quite transparent at the wavelength of light I was using, and so it didn't absorb much. It was an empty cuvette. And so the green line there is just how much did the plastic absorb or reflect. I mean, some of the light might have been reflected rather than absorbed. I also tried sticking a piece of paper in between the LED and the phototransistor, and you can see there I got a tenfold reduction in the amount of light going through, and that's reflected as that tenfold reduction in current. And you notice that once the voltage gets up to a reasonably large level, the current's basically constant. It doesn't depend much on the voltage. And that's a useful feature. You bias the phototransistor to a large enough level and you can just measure the current and not worry about the voltage. If the voltage fluctuates a little bit, it doesn't matter. The current is not going to change. You do not want to use it in the range where the voltage is very small, because there, small fluctuations in the voltage make big changes in the current. So you want to be in the region where things are constant. If this was a field effect transistor, we would call it the saturation region. That means something very different for bipolar transistors. For bipolar transistors, it's called the active region. Then the last one was taking the paper out, and I just had some light leaking in the box that was holding the cuvette. It was, you know, made out of foam core. It was not a particularly professional setup. And so the light leaking in there was a factor of 10 lower than what got through the paper. So for this particular setup that I was using, I had approximately 100-to-1 range between the most light I would see when there was nothing there and the least light I would see when I've turned off the LED and I've just got light leaking in that isn't necessarily going through the cuvette and being what I want to measure. Okay, so the important thing here to notice is that you need to have a high enough voltage from the collector to the emitter in order to bias this thing so that you can measure the current. But once you've got that bias voltage on there, it doesn't matter too much what the voltage is. The current is going to depend pretty much just on the light. Okay, let's look at a data sheet for one of these phototransistors. Now this is for the same one that I measured, I believe, the LTR 4206. And what you've got here are several different plots. The one on the bottom right, figure four here, relative collector current versus irradiance. You can see that it's basically a straight line from 0 up to 4 milliwatts per square centimeter, and then it kind of tapers off. That tapering off is because the transistor amplifier that's amplifying the current is not a perfectly linear amplifier over its entire current range. So you get usually about 3 or 4 decades of linearity out of a phototransistor, whereas a photodiode can have 7 decades of linearity. So if you're looking for a very linear sensor, a photodiode can be better than a phototransistor. It doesn't provide as much current, but if you need to do both very low levels and very high levels on a very linear way, then the photodiode gives you more linearity. Another thing to look at is figure three here, the bottom left corner. This is looking at with different load resistances, what's the rise and fall time of the phototransistor? So you turn the light on very abruptly. How long does it take the phototransistor to start or to get up to the full current it's going to do? If you turn the light off very abruptly, how long does it take the photocurrent to drop again? And the thing about phototransistors is they're kind of slow. You take a look here, if you've got a 10 kilo ohm resistor there, it may take 80 to 100 microseconds for something to rise or fall. That can be a pretty long time. I mean, if you're trying to do data communication over fiber optics and you're trying to go 10 gigabits per second, you don't want to have things that take 100 microseconds. I mean, you haven't got even a nanosecond. You've got a tenth of a nanosecond. So phototransistors don't get used much when you need high speed. Their big advantage is that they have high current, and that means that you can hook them up very easily to microcontrollers and stuff with very little circuitry. You don't have to worry about, tiny amounts of current and having to worry about a capacitive coupling of the current and stuff. You can get reasonably large currents for only modest light levels, but at the price of very slow responses. Now, for the stuff we're doing, where we're looking at things like the optical pulse monitor, speed doesn't matter. We're looking at very low frequencies, and if it takes 10 microseconds, 100 microseconds, nobody really cares. You're looking at phenomena that are happening very, very much slower than that. Even if you do something like the pulsed light on a watch, where they don't want to run the light continuously because the light is what takes all the battery power. If you pulse for a millisecond, it's still a long enough time for the phototransistor to fully settled, and you don't have to worry, as long as you don't measure it as soon as you turn the light on. If you wait 100 microseconds or so before you look at the light level, you're fine. So phototransistors are nice for getting simple circuits, high current, but they're slow and they're not as linear as photodiodes. If you look in the top left corner, you can see the other thing I talked about, which was the dark current. How much current do you get when there's no light? I mean, even a photodiode will have dark current. But because the amplification of that dark current by the transistor, you get, as much amplification as the dark current as you do of the photocurrent. So it's proportionally just as big a problem. And here is showing that the dark current is very, very temperature dependent. Notice that going from 20 degrees C to 80 degrees C is taking you up there by it looks like 3 orders of magnitude in current from a hundredth of a microamp, 10 nanoamps, up to 10 microamps. Now, those don't sound like very large values, but if you're trying to measure very small amounts of light, then the dark current is something you do have to worry about. For the stuff we'll be doing with the optical photodetector, as long as you've got enough light in the room to see with, I don't think you'll be running into problems with dark current. If you try running this thing in a very dimly lit room, then the dark current may start to matter, particularly if you start warming the phototransistor up with your finger and get it up to, you know, 35 degrees C. The dark currents will start getting a little bit more of a problem. Okay, I think that's probably all we need to have about phototransistors in order to do the optical pulse monitor lab.